Good morning and welcome to the 11th meeting in 2016 of the Health and Sport Committee. And I would ask everyone at this time who's in the room to switch off mobile phones, as they can often interfere with the sound system as well as the committee proceedings. Although those of you here will note that colleagues are using tablet devices instead of their hard copies of the papers. We have an apology this morning from Rhoda Grant, and Malcolm Chisholm is still at the devolution committee and who will join us shortly, I'm sure. The first item on the agenda today is a decision on whether the committee will consider agenda item number 10 in private. This is consideration of the main themes arising from today's evidence session, and we would normally take those considerations in private. Do I have the committee's agreement? Thank you. The second item on the agenda today is subordinate legislation, one affirmative instrument. As usual, with affirmative instruments, we will have an evidence session with the Minister for Public Health and her officials on the instrument. And once we've asked our questions, we will then move to the formal debate on the motion. The instrument we're looking at today is Public Bodies Joint Working Scotland Act 2014, Consequential Modifications Order 2016 Draft. And can I welcome the Minister for Public Health, Maureen Watt. Welcome, Minister. The Minister's accompanied today with Brian Nisbet, Senior Policy Officer, Health and Social Care Integration Directorate, and Clare McKinlay, Solicitor from the Scottish Government, and James Laing, Policy Officer, Disclosure Scotland. Welcome to you all. Minister, do you wish to make a brief opening statement?
Yes, I would like to say a few words about this draft order, Convener. The order is in consequence of the establishment of integrated joint boards under the Public Bodies Joint Working Scotland Act 2014. The purpose of this order is to amend the Protection of Vulnerable Groups Scotland Act 2007 and the Protection of Vulnerable Groups Scotland Act 2007 Prescribed Services Protected Adults Regulations 2010. These amendments are technical in nature and are necessary to ensure that the PVG scheme continues to apply to its full extent once integrated health and social care arrangements are in place. The amendments make it clear that staff delivering health and care services to vulnerable people in Scotland that are provided or secured under the integration arrangements remain within the scope of the PVG legislation. The practical impact on health boards and councils will be minimal, as staff providing these services for those organisations are already doing regulated work and so able to join the PVG scheme. These amendments should not lead to more staff having to join the PVG scheme. The changes ensure that the integration arrangements do not have the unintended effect of removing the possibility of health boards and councils to carry out PVG scheme checks in the appropriate cases. Committee members will wish to note that this order does not take forward any new policy, as it is needed simply as a result of wider legislative changes providing for integration of health and social care. And I'd be happy to take any questions if members have them.
Thank you, Minister. Are there any questions for the Minister? We don't have any further questions for the Minister. We now move to agenda item number 3, which is the formal debate on the affirmative SSI, in which we have just taken evidence. And at this point, I would remind the committee and others that members should not put questions to the Minister during the formal debates. Officials may not speak in the debate. I invite the Minister to move motion S4M15463.
Formally moved.
Thank you. Do any members wish to contribute to the debate? Okay, it remains for me then to to put the question that motion S4M15463 be approved. Are we all agreed? This is agreed, thank you. Can I now suspend for a moment to change the panel? Thank you. The fourth item on the agenda today is also subordinate legislation, another affirmative instrument. The instrument we are now looking at is Pharmacy Premises Standards, Information Obligations, etc. Order 2016 and draft. We welcome again, of course, the Minister, but the Minister is now joined by Alpana Mayor, Deputy Chief Pharmaceutical Officer, Finance, eHealth and Pharmaceuticals Directorate. Welcome to you. Minister, to make a brief statement. Thank you.
Yes, thank you, Convener. The statement's slightly longer than the previous one. The Scottish Government and the health departments in the three other nations are committed to legislative change in healthcare regulation to enhance public protection. That's why changes are being made to the General Pharmaceutical Council's legislation through this order, which is made under the Health Act 1999. This is to ensure optimal design to provide safety for users of pharmacy services while facilitating and reducing the barriers to responsible development of practice, innovation and a systematic approach to quality in pharmacy. The General Pharmaceutical Council was established in 2010 with the approval of both the Scottish and UK Parliaments. This order will make seven key amendments to the legislation governing the GPHC's processes. The first is to remove the requirement for the GPHC standards for registered pharmacy premises to be set in rules. These will now be set in a more proportionate and flexible way without requiring the use of rules which must be formalised in legislation. As a consequence of moving the premises standards out of the rules, they will no longer be included in a statutory instrument that is subject to Privy Council approval and laid before the UK and Scottish Parliaments. Standards for individual registrants are not subject to such procedures. However, the order does include an explicit and important requirement for the GPHC to consult Scottish members as well as English and Welsh ministers on changes to pharmacy premises standards. Secondly, the proposals enable GPHC to apply the standards to associated premises that are integral to the provision of pharmaceutical services as well as registered premises. This reflects the fact that in some respects the traditional model of pharmacy premises being entirely self-contained operations at which all aspects of the retail pharmacy businesses are carried on is, for some businesses, outdated. Integral parts of their business operations, for example, electronic data storage, may be elsewhere. The third amendment sets out the registration sanctions which the GPHC may use where pharmacy owners breach the standards. The General Pharmaceutical Council already has powers to issue improvement notices where a pharmacy owner breaches the standards for pharmacy premises. This order will mean that breaches of premises standards will be dealt with as a disciplinary matter by the Fitness to Practice Committee. Fourthly, the order will introduce the use of interim suspension orders by the GPHC when it is in the public interest prior to a disqualification decision or a removal decision taking effect after a full hearing of a fitness to practice case. These changes reflect the move to better align the disciplinary provisions for pharmacy owners in respect to breaches of pharmacy premises standards with those for individual registrants. As well as the changes to premises standards, the order makes some adjustments to the GPHC's powers to set rules around information gathering obligations. Should the GPHC exercise its amended powers to make rules on information obligations, these changes will be subject to further parliamentary scrutiny. The order provides for a new criminal offence to support enforcement of these rules on information obligations. This provides a backstop should a pharmacy business fail to comply with an improvement notice from the GPHC. The Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service have been consulted and indicate they are content with this. Fifthly, the order makes changes to GPHC's powers to gather information from pharmacy owners so that the regulator will be able to allocate resources proportionately by assessing the risk in a pharmacy. The order also clarifies when the GPHC can require pharmacy owners to provide such information through its rules and the type of information covered. The sixth amendment clarifies what information the GPHC may publish in reports of pharmacy premises inspections and makes clear that if a report includes personal data, it is assumed for the purposes of data protection requirements that such information can be published. Finally, the order will make a correction to terminology used in the General Pharmaceutical Council's procedure on the notification of the death of a pharmacist or pharmacy technician in Scotland. The legislation is changed to refer to a district registrar rather than the registrar general, as is currently the case. The Scottish Government considers that the best way to improve consistency, create greater efficiency, and simplify professional healthcare regulation would be to introduce a single UK bill covering all professional groups, which builds on the work of the Law Commissions. I understand that the Department of Health has now confirmed that there will not be such a bill in the near future, but they have instead proposed a consultation leading to a policy paper on future regulatory policy. The Scottish Government is disappointed at the lack of a bill, but is currently working with the Department of Health to understand the nature and extent of the new proposals. This order will make important changes to allow for optimal design to provide safety for users of pharmacy services while facilitating and reducing the barriers to responsible development of practice, innovation, and a systematic approach to quality in pharmacy. And I'm happy, Convener, to take any questions that members may have on this draft order.
Richard Lyle.
Just for clarification, premises standards, we have pharmacies standalone, we have pharmacies joined on to some doctor's surgeries, we have pharmacies within Boots, for example. Would this order instrument change allow pharmacies to be established in a grocery shop, a grocer shop, a wee corner shop somewhere, in order to encourage? We have a lot of areas where a pharmacy is not near certain the parts of the population. Would that be able to change that, or am I going down the wrong avenue?
Would you like to answer that, Alpana?
So these standards apply to registered pharmacy premises. In order for a pharmacy to be established, it would still have to go through the normal procedures currently, so it doesn't amend that or change that, or change the control of entry requirements that currently exist.
So therefore, a pharmacy can still apply to be established somewhere within a locality, and that would still be under the same regulation?
Yes, it would.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Sorry, Nanette.
I apologise if I didn't pick it up. Does this bring Scotland more into line with the rest of the UK and Northern Ireland?
Well, we would like to, as I think I said in the opening remarks, see a more level playing field. that's not going to come in the near future. But yes, we are working closely to ensure that standards are more aligned.
I just wondered what the current situation was south of the border.
So in terms of pharmacy standards, the standards, there are draft standards in place currently across the four countries, and this would just make it enforceable, and the same would apply across the four countries.
In terms of any future bill, you mentioned, Minister, there would be now a consultation. How would Scottish Pharmacy play into that consultation, and who is carrying out the consultation, and who will evaluate the results of the consultation?
So there's two aspects of it. The first one, I think you're referring to the pharmacy standards.
Yes.
That are in place. So the GPHC recently conducted a consultation which was undertaken by an independent body on behalf of the GPHC and Community Pharmacy Scotland. Other pharmacy contractors in Scotland would be able to contribute to that consultation. GPHC have taken feedback, we understand, from those comments, and revised and amended the way that they undertake the inspections.
Yeah, but there was, according to our notes, some concerns and in terms of how any breach of set of standards would be, you know, acted on or enforced, and there were some feedback. So further consultation, do you think, is wise at this stage?
I think the consultation, I understand, has been undertaken quite recently, and the consultation response was very positive in favour of the way that GPHC was progressing, the changes that they had made going forward.
But any breaches in the standard and how they would be dealt with, there were some concerns and lack of clarity there.
I think that those can be fed back to the GPHC. So when the GPHC formally set their standards, that would be open to people feeding back to the GPHC on that.
Okay. No other questions? Yes, sorry, Minister.
They brought as breaches of premises standards, but they would be dealt with as a disciplinary matter in relation to fitness to practice.
Right. Okay. We now then, we've exhausted questions, we'll now move to agenda item number 5, which is the formal debate on the affirmative SSI, which we have just taken evidence. At this point, I usually remind people that members should not put questions to the Minister during the formal debates. Officials may not speak in the debate. Can I invite now the Minister to move motion S4M15458?
I move that the Health and Sport Committee recommends that the Pharmacy Premises Standards, Information Obligations, etc. Order 2016 be approved.
Thank you. Any member wish to contribute to the debate? No. I then put the question that motion S4M15458 be approved. Are we all agreed?
Great.
Thank you. Again, we suspend to change the panel. Thank you. Item on the agenda today is oral evidence on 4 Scottish statutory instruments, which taken together provide for the regulation of independent healthcare clinics. Don't propose to read out all of those instruments as they are listed on the agenda at item 6. We welcome again this session Maureen Watt, Minister for Public Health. Minister is joined by Dr. Sarah Davis, Public Health Consultant, and Ailsa Garland, Solicitor. all from the Scottish Government. Minister, do you wish to make some opening remarks?
Thank you, Convener. Thank you for the opportunity, for providing me the opportunity, as I say, to explain the rationale behind the National Health Service Scotland Act 1978, Independent Clinic Amendment Order 2016, which, along with a commencement order which was laid at the same time as this SSI, expands the current regulation by Healthcare Improvement Scotland of independent healthcare provision to include clinics in or from which services are provided by doctors, dentists, nurses, midwives and dental care professionals. The Scottish Government commissioned an expert group which included a range of service providers, members of the public and industry regulators to develop the strategy upon which this policy is based. The outcome of the expert group's work, which the Cabinet Secretary accepted in July last year, has been developed with stakeholder engagement into this policy to extend the regulation of independent healthcare in Scotland to specific clinics to continue our programme of improving public safety and standards of care wherever services are accessed. This policy has been welcomed by many regulatory bodies, including the British Association of Cosmetic Nurses and the General Medical Council, who will be issuing new guidance for those doctors who carry out cosmetic procedures, and that guidance will be produced in the spring of this year. Significantly, many of the service providers themselves have indicated their support. While recognising that there will be costs incurred by service providers for the purposes of registration and inspection of premises, I consider this to be a necessary burden to ensure the safety of both users and providers of this industry. To talk firstly about the affirmative order before the committee, the Independent Clinic Order amends the current definition of an independent clinic in the National Health Service Scotland Act 1978 by including the additional health professions of registered nurses, registered midwives and dental care professionals. The rationale for the addition of these three groups of professionals is that due to the changing nature of the independent healthcare market in Scotland, these professionals can now offer services which can include the provision of cosmetic procedures. The proposed change in the definition is supported by the Chief Medical Officer, the Chief Nursing Officer and the Chief Dental Officer, as well as external stakeholders. This order also adds specific exemptions to the definition of an independent clinic. This reflects the policy intention that the purpose of regulation is not to regulate services which are ancillary to the purpose of an organisation, so health clinics in schools, colleges and universities or occupational health services provided solely for employees by the employer are exempted. Regulated services that are inspected by the NHS Scotland, jointly NHS and independent GP and primary dental services, and three, give a disproportionate regulatory burden to first aid clinics at sporting events, for example, or talking therapy clinics. There is a related commencement order, namely the Public Services Reform Scotland Act 2010 Commencement Number 7 Order 2016, which commences provisions in the 1978 Act so that regulation of independent clinics goes live on the 1st of April 2016 with a delay in the offence not to register a clinic until the 1st of April 2017. This year's grace will allow clinics that are new to the area of regulation to work with HIS to understand the requirements of registration and ensure their systems, policies and care are in place for the process and the following year's inspections and reports. The third instrument is the Healthcare Improvement Scotland Fees Regulation 2016. These regulations set the maximum fees that can be charged by HIS in relation to matters such as applications for registration of independent healthcare services. This is a ceiling and, as required by the enabling powers, has been consulted on together with the actual fees that HIS planned to charge for the year 2016-17. These regulations set maximum fees in relation to independent hospitals as well as clinics and revoke and replace existing fees regulations from 2011. I am aware that the The fee structure has generated some interest, but as HIS are providing this service on a cost recovery basis, it is intended to be self-funding. The final instrument is the Protection of Vulnerable Groups Scotland Act 27, prescribed purposes for consideration of suitability regulations 2016, and will allow HIS to check the suitability of a provider or manager of an independent healthcare service registered with them. In summary, the Scottish Government considers that the best way to improve patient safety in the independent healthcare clinic setting is to introduce regulation of clinics through the legislation described. And I'm happy to try and answer any questions that committee members may have.
Thanks, Minister. The first question this morning from Fiona McGlynn.
Thank you. Good morning, Minister. I know that these regulations are very much about phase one and that it's a three-phased approach towards the regulation of this industry. And I wondered if you could give us any idea of a timetable for the different phases. And also, one of the questions that came up from the roundtable that we had last week was that over the three phases, we'll end up with a situation where some clinics have to register, while some people will be regulated. And I wondered how the different ways of looking at this over the three phases all come together.
Okay, so phase one commenced in 2014. And we're obviously at the end of that stage now. So phase two will commence in April 2016 on the completion of phase one. And then we expect that probably to last to the end of this year. And then phase three will start thereafter and probably take another year.
Yes, if I can just... For phase two, there has been preliminary discussions through the expert group, but the proper work for phase two will need to be scoped and provided to the minister with recommendations. On your other question about whether some providers will be regulated and clinics regulated, at the moment the aim is that the clinics will be regulated because healthcare professionals are regulated under other circumstances. For phase two, the idea is to try and find a way of making sure that the non-surgical cosmetic procedures that are done by other healthcare practitioners, such as beauticians or hairdressers, which are a limited stock of non-surgical cosmetic procedures, such as dermal fillers, are also captured. Now, whether that would be through work with the environmental health officers who license skin piercing and tattoo parlours is to be scoped and provided with options. Phase three would be for people such as the very few healthcare scientists who provide laser services, whether their clinics would be regulated as is phase one, again, has to be scoped out.
Okay, I think that helps to get that explanation. Thank you.
Malcolm Chisholm.
To some extent, the distinction between phase one and phase two, that phase one will be the responsibility for inspection and regulation of Healthcare Improvement Scotland, and that phase two will not be their responsibility but somebody else's. Is that partly what the distinction is based on?
Well, we would need to see what exactly the outcome would be after consultation, but obviously local authorities may well have a bigger role in the second phase than they do in the first phase.
So is what's proposed fundamentally what was proposed a long time ago in the Regulation of Care Act in 2001 in terms of the inspection of independent clinics by the Care Commission as it was being set up then, but that is now obviously the role of Healthcare Improvement Scotland. Yes.
Well, yes, I wasn't around then, obviously, but I don't think that was taken forward to regulation, and then it was kind of superseded by the Christie Commission and the change to public services. But Sarah, do you want to give a better explanation?
Not all. As the Minister says, absolutely. There was the work from 2002. There was then the SMASAC report. So the CMO had a specialist advisor group looking at cosmetic surgery in 2005-06. And again, it recommended moving forward with the regulation of independent clinics. But then there was a change, as the Minister said, with moving to the work to Healthcare Improvement Scotland. And then there was a consultation by the Scottish Government on what should be done. And the block has always been this question that the regulation had, because it was right at that time, doctors and dentists' clinics had to be regulated. And what we've brought forward is the result of all the consultation that it needed a wider group of healthcare professionals.
No, I mean, there were some concerns in the evidence. We had the British Association of Aesthetic Plastic Surgeons were concerned about some situations where non-healthcare practitioners are working within independent clinics and providing cosmetic interventions. Well, I don't know whether how that will work, whether that will be part of phase two or how that will work. And secondly, the British Dental Association was concerned that, you know, the definition of independent clinic was on the healthcare professional providing the service rather than on the procedure. And the example they gave was beauticians working in beauty salons who carry out teeth whitening without any regulation or formal training. So those two situations, would they be captured by phase two, or how would they be dealt with?
If I can just answer the first question. If there is a beautician who's working in an independent clinic providing certain services, it may well be they have a nurse there, because if they're doing certain types of non-surgical cosmetic procedures, they will need a prescriber. So if you're providing certain prescribed medicines such as botulinum toxin and all its varieties, there will need to be a prescriber. So that clinic will be regulated. The person who is then delegated to give the treatment will have to be under supervision of one of those professionals. So that would be the first one. The second example with the British Dental Association, I think as the evidence heard, teeth whitening at a certain percentage of the chemicals has to be done by a dentist. So I think that one of the other aspects of this work may well be that there is greater awareness of who should be doing what.
Okay. Richard Lyle.
Thank you. Can I come on, Dr. Sarah Davis? Can I come on to that very subject? I was quite shocked, actually, when we heard the evidence about teeth whitening. And driving by one day, I noticed an advert at a tan shop that said, you know, get your teeth whitened here, which quite shocked me. You know, what would happen in regards to these premises? I'm sure we'd have to take that out, surely.
I think the legislation is quite clear that teeth whitening is a role for dentists. And I think what has happened is that this has possibly escape people's awareness always. So there are, you can, it's the percentage of the actual chemicals within the teeth whitening that has to be done by a dentist. Other can be done by different groups of people, and I believe in some situations you used to be able to buy kits in certain shops to do it at home. Whether then, so the actual level of teeth whitening that's done by dentists must only be done by dentists. I'm not answering your question,
yeah.
But the answer of the question is that if there is teeth whitening that's done that should be done by dentists and isn't being done, it should be reported.
I'll come on to my main question, but you know, if you actually look at adverts on the television, that's advertised on the television too, you can send away for these things. Anyway, I'll leave that aside. Minister, can I ask you in regards to fees? The concern I had was, I'm all for regulation. I'm all, you know, picking up people who are outside the system, and we've got to ensure that, for instance, that people who are going to get their teeth whitened, their teeth don't fall out after they've been to somewhere that's not been regulated. I'm concerned about the level of the fees. Some, you know, we're talking nearly £2,000. We have people who are independent midwives, and I see that there was a strong support against a flat registration fee. So why has this approach been proposed? I was shocked to see that basically if you apply and you don't meet the criteria and you're refused, you don't get your fee back. Keeps the fee. Although I was given the assurance that they would work with the person concerned in order to ensure that they met the criteria. But there still is that case now. We've got independent nurses or independent midwives, etc., people who maybe are working, with the greatest respect, outside the health service and are making a living, you know, they're going to be faced with a fee of something like in the region of nearly £2,000 in order to set up. Will that encourage people? Why don't we have it as a sliding scale? Why don't we have it that if they don't meet the criteria, that they do get a proportion of their fee back? Because I certainly wouldn't like to hand you £2,000 and then for you to turn around and say, no, you don't meet the criteria and I don't get my £2,000 back.
I take your point, but, you know, as I said in my opening statement, it is, his are working on full cost recovery, so the same work has to be done regardless of the person making the application. And this was discussed by the his board, and it was judged that having a flat fee would be the fairest approach for the first year. I think we need to put this in context. I think there are probably only about three independent midwives in Scotland, but all providers, including midwives, will have a full calendar year to register and discuss the process with his. I don't know if you want to add anything, Sarah.
And if I can just add again, as you heard from last week with his, the registration process, and as we've been hearing from his already with people putting in applications, it is really quite a discursive process. So it isn't provide us the money, we don't return it. There is really a lot of consultation going on. They're providing as much as possible and they can do in the way of templates of the type of policies that people are meant to have. So it's quite a long process to work through before there is a definite sort of handing over of a cheque and then it not being returned.
Convener, if you allow me. So if someone applies, can they sit down with his and talk through what they want to do prior to paying over their money so that they can then say, well, you know, I don't think I'm going to meet the criteria there. I'll go and do something else. Or, yes, thank you very much.
Some supplementaries on that. I mean, you know, I take your point, and the evidence we had confirms that there are few independent midwives, but they are there, they're doing a job, they'll be affected by these measures. You know, it's quite a difference, isn't it? Optical Express, for instance, paying the same flat fee in the premises of, you know, midwives. But the other aspect that's been raised with us is about what aspects of independent midwives' work would be inspected. You know, they don't operate on the high street, they operate in people's homes. You know, so as well as the challenge of fairness of fees that would be levied upon them, there's a question of how would you affect the objectives of the measures.
If I can answer that, I think as we heard from his before, the idea of the regulation is to review current practices in a range of areas. So it's the clinical governance as well as the business matters. So for a midwife, for instance, what they would be expecting in the same way as independent nurses who are maybe providing services in a range of places but just have a small clinic, they would want to check record keeping, decontamination of any objects, how people do their complaint system. So it's both the governance and the clinical governance of the service and the financial viability. That's the sort of thing that they would be wanting to look at in the place that the midwife decrees is her probably office. Then the work that she does in people's homes, there would be a report on it so that they're not inspecting individual homes where she provides those services, but she wants to make sure, they want to make sure that the service as an entity is a viable entity and meets the standards that are required for any kind of service.
Complying with standards and the registration fee, I presume, as being a nurse and a midwife, she's regulated with all of that, so that assures some of the quality issues. How would someone who purchases those additional services provide ensure, how would that get an outcome that's better quality or safer or whatever when they're already regulated, just other than paying the thousands of pounds fee to be registered?
But there's a big difference between operating in a hospital or a dentist premises or even an independent hospital compared to working in a person's home. And as Sarah said, you know, it is about decontamination or making sure that the equipment used is properly cleaned and up to standard. It is, in the end of the day, about protection of consumers, you know, and in this case, they're not doing it in an already regulated environment. They're doing it out with that. So I think it's important that standards are high.
Yeah. I suppose a wee supplementary on the dentist then, because there were some questions last week's committee about how they currently are inspected and their request that any inspections that would be carried out on basically private dentists would be carried out by dentists. And there was some comment in the committee in regards to why dentists delivering and contracted to deliver in the health service are actually got a different inspection regime was this not an opportunity to bring dentistry as a whole into being regulated and inspected by HIS? Why do they stand separate from?
I think, given your evidence session before recess, I think many people will have been.
It wasn't last week.
Not last week.
The recess went so quickly.
I think many people were surprised that private dentists weren't regulated at all. I mean, you go to a private dentist, pay a lot of money, and there is no regulation. So I think people, consumers, will be very pleased that there will now be regulation of dentists who operate completely out with the NHS system, are completely private.
Yeah, but it will be different, you know.
Yes, there'll be
an opportunity here to.
They'll be regulated according to the same sort of inspection of independent hospitals. So it's not quite the same as the NHS where public money is involved.
So you agree with the principle that dentists should be inspecting themselves, which is what the majority of an inspection of a dental practice within a National Health Service stands separately from the new regime, and it's dentists per se that carry out those inspections, qualified dentists that carry out those inspections. They are happy with that situation, of course, and the only plea that I think they made to the committee was that, you know, if we're going to inspect the private dentist, then it should be dentists that should carry out that inspection.
If I can, at the moment, what the situation, as I think you've probably heard from the evidence gathering, health boards inspect the dental practices that are under the NHS. And the aim which work is that HIS is doing at the moment with the General Dental Council and other dental groups is to make sure that the inspections that HIS will now start of purely private dentists both meets what HIS wants to do for independent healthcare examination and regulation, but also, you know, ties into what the health boards are getting at the moment from other NHS dental inspections. So I think, as you heard from the plastic surgeon, that when there are, and he was saying that HIS will need experts to do examinations of different types of clinics, getting dentists who are independent to inspect other dental practices is what happens at the moment for the NHS.
You know, it's like saying that doctors can only inspect doctors and nurses can only inspect nurses. Is it not?
Absolutely.
That doesn't. Has not staff, you know, the inspectors that go out there have got a speciality in inspecting a whole, you know, general part. You mentioned bookkeeping and record keeping, and you know, so I just think there's an inconsistency here which has been highlighted by the new measures. That's all. And you know, there is a big argument that HIS itself is not independent enough from health boards, and we've got health boards inspecting dentists and dentists carrying out inspections. You know, and managing risk and hierarchy and hazard, that doesn't seem a good, you know, a reassuring model. But you know,
I think we would expect the inspection procedures to be drawn up with healthcare professionals, whether it be doctors, dentists, in the mix, into drawing up the procedures. They might not necessarily carry out the inspection, but at least they've had an input into the procedures that are followed during the inspection.
Oh, they inspect them against standards, but the idea that, you know, we must have more dentists than we had 10 years ago now that are about carrying out inspections, we can only put in the net.
An uncanny knack of answering the questions that I'm going to ask, but don't worry about it. To get back to the independent midwives, I was quite surprised to see that particular group of people included in this, because I understand they are pretty heavily regulated by the Nursing Midwifery Council anyway. And I just wondered, what can HIS do that's actually better than their current regulators as far as inspecting them? It seemed a bit odd to me that they were included.
Yes, I mean, the reason that they were included was to cover the two areas. One is the midwifery, and one is if there are any midwives who are also taking additional training and involved in cosmetic procedures. So that was why they were included, because the expert group advised that there are some midwives who are also doing cosmetic procedures out with their midwifery practice. So it was to make sure that there was no gaps in the healthcare professionals who are providing those type of services. On the issue of the midwifery service, I think they are very well regulated at the moment. Whether the actual clinic organisation in the sense of the total services they're providing is looked at is not clear, because they are regulated for parts of the services that they provide, but not the totality.
That's helpful, because I actually hadn't picked up about the cosmetic side, I must say. And I mean, are you confident that HIS seems to be involved an awful lot nowadays in many areas of health inspection? Confident that HIS will be able to get the appropriate people to do this?
HIS have been provided with extra resources to deal with this extra work.
Okay. Thank you, Kendra.
Thanks. No other questions, Richard? No other questions? No. Just to pick up on one of Richard's questions earlier, in terms of professionals offering services, you know, on, I think you mentioned online, or you know, on TV or whatever, that online providing services in Scotland, but where the business itself is registered out with Scotland, or where there's no fixed business premise or a PO box or whatever, will companies like that be required to register?
Where there's services that are provided from a base in England, they will obviously be being regulated by the Care Quality Commission. Where there is services that are provided in Scotland, where at all possible, they will be regulated under this regulation. It's quite difficult with a PO box or a website, but HIS is already looking into how they can track that down to make sure that there's some type of registration.
Come on.
It could be.
A loophole for... teeth whitening.
I think it's more that it's a question of how easy is it going to be, how practical can HIS do the regulation of those types of services. But they will be saying to people with websites, if you're providing services in Scotland, you must be regulated. So they will be
telling
them...
That will be the basic requirement.
Exactly.
Whether they will or not, or how we make them, but
exactly.
will be
but
a challenge.
They will be saying, for people in Scotland, the services to people in Scotland must be registered through HIS.
Okay. No other questions? Thanks very much for that. We now move to agenda item number 7, which is a formal debate on the affirmative SSI, which we have just taken evidence, and again, I remind the committee and others that members should not put questions to the minister during formal debates. Our officials may not speak in the debate. I invite the minister to move motion S4M15452.
Formally moved, convener.
Thank you. Any members? Richard Lyle wishes to contribute to the debate.
I would certainly agree to this regulation. At the end of the day, I know it will tighten up the situation. You know, as I said earlier, I was quite concerned 2 weeks ago when we were told that teeth whitening can be done anywhere and I saw it in a notice outside a shop. The only concern I have, I've sought the assurance, and I'm sure that it will be, is the costs, and that if someone applies it, they don't get their funding back. But again, I've sought the assurance, and we'll be given the assurance that people will be allowed to sit down, discuss with us, and ensure that they're not paying over for them to come back a couple of weeks later to say, sorry, you don't meet the criteria. So with that regard, I'm certainly support this amendment.
No other member? No. Minister, want to sum up? Okay. I then put the question, that is motion S4M15452 be approved. Are we all agreed?
Great.
Thank you. I'll suspend for a moment. Thank you, Minister, and your colleagues who have accompanied you this morning. Thanks very much. I'll just take a moment while we... We now move to agenda item number 8 and more subordinate legislation. We have two negative instruments before us, both of which were part of the evidence we have taken on regulating independent clinics. First instrument is Healthcare Improvement Scotland Fees Regulations 2016, SSI 2016/26. There has been no motion to annul, and the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee haven't made any comments on the instrument. Do any of the committee members have comment? If not, is the committee agreed to make no recommendations? Thanks. That is agreed. Thank you. The second instrument before us is the Protection of Vulnerable Groups Scotland Act 2007, prescribed purposes for consideration of suitability regulation 2016, SSI 2016/27. There have again been no motion to annul, and the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee has not made any comments on the instrument. Do the committee members have any comment? There's no comment. Therefore, the committee agreed to make no recommendations?
Good.
Thank you. That is agreed. Thank you. And I'll suspend now until 10:30, when we expect our witnesses to be with us. Thank you. We now move to agenda item 9, which is oral evidence session on access to new medicines, progress and update. Round table, so it's time for everybody to introduce themselves, although we've been here before, many of us, as I look round the table. But my name's Duncan McNeill. I'm the MSP for Greenock and Inverclyde and convener of the Health and Sport Committee.
My name's Leslie Lolliger and I'm the chair of the charity PNH Scotland.
Good morning, Dennis Robertson, SNP member for Aberdeenshire West.
Malcolm Chisholm, MSP for Edinburgh Northern and Leith.
Lee Smith from Melanoma Action and Sport Scotland, but representing the Health and Social Care Alliance here today.
Mike McKenzie, MSP, and I represent the Highlands and Islands.
Natalie Frankish, Development Officer for Scotland for Genetic Alliance UK and Rare Disease UK.
Good morning, Colin Keir, Edinburgh Western MSP.
Good morning, Mark White, Director of Finance from NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde.
Good morning, Richard Lyle, MSP for Central Region.
Hi, Aileen Muir, Lead Pharmacist for Governance for Greater Glasgow and Clyde.
Lynette Milne, MSP for North East Scotland.
Rob Jones, I'm a medical oncologist at the Beats and in Glasgow.
Fiona McLeod, I'm the MSP for Strathkelvin and Bearsdene and the Deputy Convener of the Committee.
Good morning, I'm Sandra Auld, I'm Director of ABPI in Scotland.
Good morning, I'm Katrina McMahon. I'm the lead SMC member for industry working with ABPI and other companies, and I'm also an Edinburgh trained physician.
Great. Thank you for that, those introductions. We're going to go directly to Nanette Millen, who's going to start us off. Nanette, thank you.
Thank you, Convener. I'm very interested in hearing how things are progressing with the access to new medicines, because as you know, the committee has done quite a lot of work on this over the years. I can ask people around the table, how do you think access to new medicines has improved since we did all our investigations? Have there been any changes in particular that have been successful in improving access to these drugs? And where does progress still need to be made? And I'm particularly interested in the uptake of the New Medicines Fund, how that's going.
Okay. Well, I think that sets the scene, Nanette. Who's first? We have had the written evidence, which alludes to some of that, but there is an opportunity to have some of that on the record here today. Who's first? Leslie, go on.
Thank you. Yeah. I was very fortunate 2 weeks ago to take part in the new PACE meetings that have been taking place in SMC. I just wanted to say what an amazing opportunity it was to have the chance as a patient to speak about my condition, to speak about the costs that are in existence other than just the basic costs of the actual drug, to have clinicians that can speak on behalf of the drug, people that are experts in my condition and experts in my drug. I also wanted to say that before the PACE meeting, I was given the most amazing help and support by the SMC in preparation for it, a one-to-one preparation and help that was just second to none. Now, you said what things could be improved. Obviously, there are things that can. My drug is also used for another condition called atypical hemolytic uric syndrome, AHUS. They also had a PACE meeting in December. By all accounts, it went very well. They've been turned down for the drug. Now, it makes perfect sense to me that not every drug can be accepted. That's not what we were looking for in this process. However, the wording of the rejection slightly concerned me, because it did seem to still imply that we're looking at the bottom line cost of drugs and expense of drugs, and I completely understand that. But I still feel we're slightly missing on the understanding of the overall cost, the difference that this makes to people's lives, the extra things that would have to be in position like dialysis, etc. So I still think we need a little bit of clarity on how the decisions are made. And also if there's a rejection because a drug is far too expensive, which I completely understand, I would like some sort of clarity in what negotiations go on after that stage, where a drug company can be kind of brought to task. And these things maybe happen, but if it was something that a patient or a clinician could have more sight of, then we'd have more faith in the system And we'd also have a bit of hope that we've got a path of care still available to us. Thank you.
Thanks. Anyone else? Yes, Robin?
So I try to represent the views of my colleagues at the Beats. And we've noticed a significant lowering of the threshold for acceptance of drugs by the SMC. And that's the bottom line, I think. There are, by and large, we're very enthusiastic about the PACE scheme, those of me and my colleagues who've taken part, and I've taken part myself, because it gives an opportunity to give information over and above what can come out in a written submission. There is a little bit of perplexity. We do accept that even when a PACE group warmly supports the use of a drug, it won't always be accepted. But I think there is a feeling that we would like a clearer explanation, particularly where the PACE group has given a very resounding support to a drug when it is then rejected, a clearer explanation from the SMC as to specifically why the PACE group's recommendations have been rejected. I think as far as the SMC goes, yes, there's tangible improvements. Of course, the other aspect to access to medicines is the individual patient treatment request. And I think there have been some concerns amongst colleagues that this has led to different thresholds being set for acceptance of the same medicine in what would be the same clinical circumstances from one region of Scotland to another. And that's something none of us are keen to support. And the PACS, or the PAC system, I can't actually remember what it stands for now, and none of us have seen any evidence of this in action yet. And I think we feel that that's an opportunity to try and level the interregional variability in individual patient treatment request. We are also keen that even with a sort of an overarching agreement on access, this is about access to medicines where the SMC have not accepted the use, that there should still be retained an individual patient treatment pathway, though, whatever process comes in place with PACS.
Trying to encourage, I see the MSPs up, they can put their hands up all day, but we've got this panel here, and we're going to give them a voice. Lee.
Thank you. I would hope that everyone has read Dr. Andrew Walker's submission. Andrew is an academic, you could say poacher turned gamekeeper turned poacher, hard to say from his record. But he has laid out quite clearly in his submission exactly how many drugs have been accepted, and there is a definite improvement. But I would have to echo what Dr. Jones has said. I've been to four PACE meetings, and on each occasion we felt that a really strong, well supported by SMC staff, plea was made for a drug, both by ourselves, a patient, and the consultant who deals with melanoma patients at the Beatson. And we came away from the PACE meeting feeling that we had done our best, it had been accepted, and all would be well. But then you go along to the full meeting and watch the result of that. And what comes across very strongly, and it's part of the transparency, you can see very clearly that really the place for the clinician would have been at the full meeting to answer any questions that are still unanswered, to allow the committee to make a properly informed decision. And I was dreadfully disappointed to find that one of the drugs that we'd pleaded for was accepted for first-line use, and then because of questions which were unanswered in the final meeting, we lost out on second-line use. And we have a whole batch of patients who have done well on a first-line immunotherapy treatment who will in time start to fail on that or will not respond to it, and they desperately need to have the second line therapy. And it does mean it's going to have to go to a resubmission, and that takes even more time. And I really feel that clinicians' time is desperately important. We are very, very short of clinician time for melanoma patients, and we can't afford to be giving up any more of it to bureaucracy. Thank you.
Okay. Any other panel member? Natalie.
I would just agree exactly with what Lee has said there. I think one of the real strengths of the new system is the way patients and clinicians are involved in the PACE process, and the PACE process has certainly been an excellent step forward. The patient involvement team, in particular with the SMC, do an absolutely fantastic job in raising awareness of what the SMC does and how patients can be involved in it. But I think where there is a glaring omission is when it comes to that final decision meeting and there's not a patient or a clinician around the table to answer those questions. And sometimes things can get lost in the discussion or tangents be taken, which would benefit from the ability, I think, of a clinician or a patient to clarify a point. And I think that's the necessary next step to take. There's certainly room now for the pharmaceutical industry to sit around the table and answer questions. That same courtesy, I think, should be extended to patients and clinicians.
Sandra.
ABPI would like to commend the change in process that SMC have gone through. It has been substantial and they have worked very, very hard to pull through the changes in process. If the intention was to have more acceptances, then that is what has happened quite dramatically. What continues to need to happen is that the system continues to need to evolve to deal with the continuing new medicines and the types of new medicines that are coming through and will continue to be presented to SMC. If SMC wants to stay at the forefront and be the world-recognised organisation that they are, there will need to be a continued evolution. Dr. Jones mentioned IPTRs and the PAC system. It has become clear that there needs to be a safety net for medicines that are not recommended. We are waiting to see what the replacement for IPTRs is. And I'm not clear what the pilot. I know that there has been discussion around a pilot in Glasgow. I'm not clear of any of the detail of that. But as I say, it has become clear that there is absolutely a need for a safety net for these medicines.
Anyone else? I mean, I think from the written evidence and from what people have said here that genuine progress has been made. Committee, we're looking for more yeses in the system. There's clearly more yeses in the system. People appreciate the engagement and the involvement and the opportunity to give that greater detail. I think all that was coming out of that in Evans as well. But they also, do they listen, I suppose? And is it always going to be down to, I'm looking at Mark here because you're the man with the balance sheet. In terms of the cost I'm referring to your written submission in terms of the cost and diversion of resources, et cetera, and what limits that will go here.
Yeah, I mean, there's not much more to add. I mean, the New Medicines Fund has been excellent in terms of allowing us to, allocate resources to what would be rare and orphan drugs, without diverting resources from other areas of our healthcare provision. So, yeah, we are very supportive and would hope it would continue.
What level of funding that comes down to, the likes of Glasgow and
In 2015-16, the New Medicines Fund, the total pot was £90 million for Scotland, of which in our NRAC share for NHS Glasgow equates to around about £22-23 million of that. So that's the level of funding we get. Yeah. Initial numbers for 16-17 are down on that. We're still trying to finalise them and work through with our Scottish Government colleagues, but that's the level of funding that equates to a board the size of Glasgow.
Yeah. Down to the 23, it's down, so there's a gap that's 16.
Likely there will be. We're still finalising those numbers.
Have you been spending your allocation, I suppose?
Oh, absolutely, yeah. Spending more than our allocation. So it does contribute, but it's still not enough. We've got to find other funding from other sources to fully fund, but yeah, it's very helpful.
Does anyone want to pick up on the... I mean, I think we've got somebody here from Glasgow. We've not got other boards represented, but the issue of the regional application of some of this, I think Rob mentioned that in terms of the submission from Beatson as well, and that in some other areas that it might the progress is not as great, or some don't want to. I think you used the post code prescribing.
I think it would be helpful if there were, you know, one of the questions the committee asked was, has this improved access to new medicines? So we are able to say that it's certain, the approval rate has certainly improved, but whether that has actually translated into patients being able to access these new medicines, we're not clear. And I think it would be helpful to have, for example, perhaps Healthcare Improvement Scotland identified as an organisation to monitor the implementation of SMC decisions moving forward. And then it would be clear throughout the health boards what was happening where.
Can somebody give a, you know, you might want to come back, Sandra, and give us a full explanation of that, because I'm, in my simple mind, you know, more money, more patients overall, how there's a contradiction between patient access and... Yes, please, Leslie, help me.
What I was going to say was that we were trying to get rid of the IPTR system. That was one of the things that was meant to happen. We were moving to PACS, which was alluded to, and that obviously hasn't happened. So in the interim, we still have a situation that each health board has their own IPTR protocol, which they are following. And I went in and printed out, you know, most of the protocols that I could find, IPTR protocols from the different regions, and they still are asking for patients to have significant difference in their clinical circumstances and having a significant difference in the way that a drug would affect them. Now, as you know, from my condition, we have 15 in Scotland on the drug, and it's very hard to be different in amongst a cohort of 15 people. Yeah. So the issue that we're having is that the practice is an IPTR form that still requests exceptionality, by another word, by clinical difference. Mm-hmm. And that's an issue. We need to see PACS in place.
Rob?
Yeah, so I'm the guilty person for using the term postcode prescribing. I did qualify it with low level. and this does concern clinicians, and it concerns patients as well. And when it's an SMC acceptance, we have no tangible concerns about differences in implementation. I'm not saying there aren't any, but I have no evidence for that. But it is about these, the non-accepted, and that may be prior to an SMC review, of course. So it may be something which is ultimately accepted by the SMC. Prior to July 2013, there were reasonably clear definitions of when an IPTR should be accepted, and by and large it meant that it wouldn't be accepted. And clearly we have seen a dramatic lowering of the threshold, but the problem is that there are now no clear criteria by which an IPTR should be accepted. And so the same patient submitted to different parts of Scotland may get a different answer, and that's the problem. Now, a national agreed system would be good, but I would reiterate we are very keen to retain the process by which individual patients' needs could still be met. Notably, in England, there is virtually no process now by which an individual patient needs can be assessed, and that causes a lot of problems for patients in England, and I don't think we want to see that happening in Scotland.
Good. Yeah, you're in the bottom of a long list, Richard. But Dennis Robertson.
Thank you, Convener. And it really is to continue the discussion on the IPTR. And Leslie says that you know, he wanted to abolish it, basically. The Cabinet Secretary, in her evidence, suggested that there had been a substantial increase to medicines because the IPTR had been reviewed. Do you agree with that submission from the Cabinet Secretary?
There's been an increase in access to medicines.
Yeah, substantive increase, basically.
Yeah, no, I didn't want to, it wasn't that I wanted to get rid of the IPTR. I mean, in the access to new medicines, that was one of the things that was discussed. It was basically an overhaul of the IPTR system. I would say that the New Medicines Fund has increased access to medicines quite considerably, and I know that all the patients that have my condition all have the drug. So without a doubt, something is working. I guess the point here is to try and make sure that we fill in those gaps that still need to be looked at. It's where it would be unfair. I still find myself in my patient group when a new patient comes in, I'll ask them which area they come from in Scotland, and I want to get rid of that. I don't want to have to keep asking that. So I want it to be fair throughout the country. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Sandra, you want to respond to Dennis's question?
We understand that there has been a specific issue with IPTRs once a medicine has not been recommended by SMC, that medicines which had been approving, there had been IPTRs approved for, once medicine is not recommended by SMC, may be subject, and in the gap between that and a resubmission, that there has been a sharp decline and maybe a complete cessation of approval of IPTRs. So again, these are patients who are no longer able to access a medicine, and that's a real concern for us.
Anyone else in response to Dennis's questions? Natalie and Lee?
From a patient organisation perspective, our member groups come to us and we have had much less criticism of the IPTR system and fewer people coming to us with real tangible problems that aren't down to communication, really, from clinicians. I think there's a little bit of a difficulty because we can say for sure there has been an increase in the number of people accessing medicines through this route, but we don't really know why. And I think that comes down to the lack of guidance that is available. The interim guidance for the IPTR says that there is no exceptionality. The forms suggest there still is. So it's a little bit inconsistent, I think, the message that's coming on what is actually happening on the ground. The PAC system was definitely something that we were really supportive behind, and our patient groups really are very keen to see moving forward. Understandably, there has to be a pilot. We need to know that that transition will be smooth for patients and that patients don't then end up getting lost in the system. But the lack of communication on that as well has been slightly disappointing, because it would be good to know and be able to tell patient groups what's happening, when it's going to happen, and have an understanding of the system before it comes in place.
We have not had anyone apply for IPTR or through IPTR to have a drug for melanoma, have it accepted. And because of the changes in the system and companies seeing an opportunity to perhaps be reheard by the SMC, it appears that the SMC's workload has increased substantially. The time gap between a drug being licensed and it being heard by the SMC appears to be growing, as if perhaps there just isn't enough time or enough staff to process it. And we have patients in desperate need of new drugs at this time, which are licensed, are accepted in England and have not been accepted in Scotland because they haven't been tried yet, or we haven't got it for second line use and not IPTR either. A lot has improved. I was delighted to read the GGHB submission where they say that patients with cystic fibrosis and renal disease have benefited from the new medicines fund, but equally it's very disconcerting to read that the Beatson people have not seen any of this money and they haven't benefited at all, despite the fact that the Beatson is in Glasgow where the pilot scheme is. So I hope I haven't misunderstood that. Thank you.
Just to clarify that, none of the consultants at the Beatson are aware of that, but actually a lot of the assumption is that the money takes place behind the scenes. So I don't think it was one of the specific questions asked and we've just seen no evidence of it, but I don't think there's a suggestion that it's not happening.
Yeah, that's absolutely correct. What we do is, behind the scenes, we look at what medicines have been prescribed by the consultants, and we would then submit that list to the Scottish Government to access the new medicines fund. So I don't think it's unexpected that the consultants themselves wouldn't have anything to do with that in particular, because that's been data that comes out of the system. So it has been accessed widely for the appropriate medicines.
Dennis, you wish you...
Yeah, thank you. Leslie mentioned different protocols from different areas, and Dr. Jones, you've said that perhaps a national guidance would be maybe more effective, although you still look for that sort of individuality aspect of it as well. Who would write this national guidance? Yourself?
So I'm not sure necessarily guidance is the way forwards, because actually it's very difficult to formulate guidance. Yeah. What we want to see is greater consistency across the country. There are a variety of mechanisms by which you could generate that. One of my concerns about the PACs is that, of course, actually, well, we want to move away from exceptionality. And yes, we do. But actually, what do we move to? because clearly it can't be blanket acceptance, because that's the SMC's job. It's very difficult, but there may well be systems by which clinicians can get together to at least try and find processes to ensure that access is to minimise inequalities of access.
Would you have a proposal in mind?
This may not be the place to put these forwards. I think there are a couple of potential ways in which this could be done. One of which could be to meet and try and agree criteria as specialist groups. So, for example, I treat prostate cancer. Well, there are only about a dozen of us in Scotland who you will prescribe these drugs. We do meet regularly. We all know each other. And we could at least get together, and indeed we've tried to do this, to try and at least define what our wishes would be there. But even that's quite difficult. A second approach would be some form of process by which IPTRs are, or whatever replaces them, are at least reviewed on a national basis. Because I don't actually know what happens to an IPTR in Lothian. I know what happens to all of the ones in the west of Scotland within the four member health boards there. So there are a number of ways you could do this.
That's very helpful.
Anyone else got a solution to some of those problems? I wish to make some comment. Yes, please, Leslie.
I think we come back to the thing that I raised originally when we first started talking about this, which is the fact that for very, very rare conditions, you have very few specialists in that condition. And for me, for example, I have one recognised expert in Scotland. So we come down to the fact that we need a centre of excellence for different conditions. I know that wouldn't necessarily be possible for every condition. From my point of view, I'm very grateful I have my recognised expert close by, but that isn't the same for every patient throughout the country, and they deserve to have that same expertise when their drug regime is being considered.
The other issue I think it was mentioned by Lee is the unintended consequences, delays and potential negotiation, and I think there was some of the written evidence that said, well, if we're creating a system that the pharmaceuticals are going to, with a bid to provide these drugs and medicines, then and expect to be maybe sent back with that, then that distorts the system as well. So, Mark, I'm looking at you because it was your written evidence.
Pass to my colleague.
I'm just looking for delays in the system because in a lot of this we're talking about small numbers of people, individuals that you're all trying to help, and if that process becomes burdensome, becomes for the people who are trying to administer and get these processed, as well as a negotiation process and whatever, then that's got an implication. It's disproportionate with the people that we're dealing with at the end of life, and we need to have some discussion about that. Aileen, and then I'll get back to Mark.
In our submission from Greater Glasgow and Clyde, what we were saying was we would rather see the pharmaceutical industry come forward with their best price right at the beginning of the process rather than us have to go back or wait for a patient access scheme in the middle of the process for SMC. So that would be a much more efficient way forward rather than expecting to have some price reduction in the middle of the process. So that is for efficiency, I think, in everyone's time, we would prefer to see that.
Anything to add, Mark?
Yeah, nothing more to add, by the fact that I reiterate that comment. I think some of the discounts we subsequently get are sizeable and it can be very beneficial, but it's almost after the event, if you like. So that level of negotiation early in the process would be more helpful.
How would you know that's the best price? Anyway,
I couldn't comment.
I can't help but think that a great deal of expertise is used at the various meetings where perhaps the best people to negotiate a price with a pharmaceutical company would be someone who's a skilled negotiator, dealing with a skilled negotiator from the pharma industry, because that's certainly what you're going to get. And in the past, it would fall to the principal pharmacist to work out a deal on drugs and the cost that they would pay. And they were in very close contact with each other. And if somebody got a penny off a pack more than someone else, believe me, the pharma people got to know about it very quickly. And I can't help but think that the place of the SMC might be to ignore the price and the negotiation side of things, decide on whether or not we need this drug in Scotland, how much of it we're going to need, and feed that to someone who is a negotiator and get them to screw down the pharmaceutical company to get the very best price from them. And that is repeated by Andrew Walker in his submission too. Thank you.
Yes, Sandra.
Again, I would like the committee to be focusing on the value of medicines rather than the price, and again looking at the medicines that are these newer medicines that are going to be coming through for very small patient populations, and how the system that we have in place can be adapted to be able to deal with those medicines so that patients in Scotland can access them. I think there is a real opportunity in Scotland because of the way our NHS and academic centres are designed, that we can really lead the way here, and I think it's an opportunity that we need to be making most of.
I think we're just trying to establish whether it's an issue. You know, when we look as a committee to recommend evolution of this process, then, you know, is it an issue or is it not? Certainly for...
There could be a more efficient way of doing things. We do have within Scotland National Procurement, who are the body that looks at negotiating and prices. However, when a new medicine comes to the market, that's often not the time that happens, although it's up to the pharmaceutical industry to come forward with a patient access scheme at that point. So it's the onus is on the industry at that point, the way it stands just now.
Malcolm. I think you had a bit.
I was thinking of coming in, but I mean, I suppose I'm interested in just seeing where there's agreement so we can know what to push for in terms of change. I was struck at the beginning just by the emphasis on the PACE process, because Genetic Alliance UK, the Beats, and seem to be saying much the same thing, and I've been supporting this campaign by Breast Cancer now, who are saying the same thing. Why aren't patients and clinicians, you know, available at SMC meetings? So there seems to be agreement on that. I mean, I suppose one area I would be interested in a bit more on is just the IPTR process. Again, for example, Breast Cancer now would welcome consideration of a national decision-making system. And I just wonder whether, in fact, we should be trying to establish some improvement now to the IPTR system, whether it's that or some other one, or whether, in fact, we should just be looking to get the PAC system introduced as soon as possible, although it seems clear from what Professor Jones said that won't necessarily solve all the problems. So I haven't really got a sense of any consensus around what we should do for those the kind of situations that are covered currently by the IPTR system.
Natalie?
It's quite difficult to answer that question until we know the outcome of the pilot that's happening in Glasgow. So whilst we're unsure what that's actually going to look like, I think it's important to remember that PACS was developed through a real multi-stakeholder consultation on what should be the best system. And as a result, you would hope that that would have some positive impact. But until the pilot is communicated and what has actually happened there, I think it's hard to know how that will look in practice. For me and from the patient organisations that we consult with, there is a frustration that PACS hasn't come into place yet, and a real keenness to see that develop quickly now that there is a pilot. But until we know the results of what that pilot has looked like, it's hard to know exactly how that will work in practice.
Anyone else? Please.
I think there's a natural tension in the system whereby we're looking for being able to identify what is the best treatment for the individual patient who's in front of us on that day as a consequence of their clinical need, versus the national perspective of actually having a proposal which would manage the majority of requests that might come through. And as Professor Jones says, I mean, that's individuality is very important, and it's SMC's job to actually give the blanket positioning on a medicine where it's possible to do so. And it, for me, as Natalie says, it's very much actually about consultation is about working through the pros and cons, and it's about testing the system to identify where the best answer sits. And my own feeling is that it would be very difficult to put a solution in place that would be national and would cover all disease processes. In actual fact, what would probably end up with at best case scenario is something that's very individual for each disease process. So every patient group basically has its own system, because needs vary very much according to what the presenting issues of the patients are. So yes, I'd love to be able to say there's a one-stop answer to this, but I think there's a very natural tension in the system that is going to make that very difficult.
So there could be some national criteria for individual diseases. I think that's what Professor Jones was saying about prostate cancer as well, wasn't it?
Matt?
I'm trying not to speak specifically about prostate cancer. I think there are some opportunities where you could say this particular group of patients defined by X, Y, and Z should be able to access this drug, which is not accepted by the SMC. The problem is that will probably, first of all, it will be disease indication specific, actually. And it's not going to, I suspect it will not deal with the majority of situations where a patient's individual needs are for a drug which is not accepted by the SMC. So it can't deal with the whole problem.
Yes,
and this is where I think the opportunity sits around process rather than specific guidance or specific decision. It's how do we ensure that it's the processes that we put in place actually reduce the confusion and the complexity rather than having the individual, rather than having definitive decisions.
Lee?
I don't want to concentrate too much on my own disease area, but with melanoma, there's only 4 or 5, if there's even that, clinicians in Scotland who are likely to be using the sorts of drugs that we're discussing. And Scotland is a small country. We have, 1,200 roughly new cases of melanoma each year, of which only maybe 200 at most will go on to need this sort of drug. Following up what actually happens to these patients when they're given a new drug over a certain threshold would provide so much more evidence, a sort of post-marketing surveillance. What really happens with these drugs when they're used in Jock Thompson's Bairns instead of patients who are carefully selected for drug trials for a variety of reasons? That if we then fed back to the pharmaceutical industry the results of real-life, everyday usage of their drugs, we might well be able to negotiate an even better price for the information that we could sell them, which would then be used throughout the rest of the world. We are just an ideal size for this kind of research, and we're in dire need of knowing exactly how much benefit we get from the huge spend that we make on these very expensive drugs. And it's not impossible. There are computer programs available which can have patient input about their everyday side effects, for instance. And every time someone gets a side effect, that means an intervention, perhaps a hospital visit, perhaps another drug, and it all adds to the cost. And we really need the global cost of treating these diseases, not just the price of the drug.
Natalie, did you want to?
I just completely agree with that statement. I think the wider view of what the value is definitely something that needs to continue to be discussed and taken forward with the SMC. And I think in terms of the SMC decisions, whilst we have seen an increase across the board, really, since the changes have taken place, I think it's difficult to know the reasons why those changes have happened. And is it because of pace? Is it because of the patient access scheme? Is it because of cost? What is the contributory decision-making factor? And I think there needs to be a process for a constant evaluation of these decisions going forward so we can pinpoint the point in the process that the decision-making is being made on. And that would give us some scope for, I think, making the process sustainable for the future.
Catriona.
I think we're talking very, very similarly here. When we're actually looking at what we need to be doing in the future, we're looking at a very significant change in the regulatory structures that are happening, whereby medicines are now being approved on on evidence which is more immature than healthcare systems have been used to date. And also when we're looking at the rare diseases or ultra-rare diseases, again, we're looking at an evidence base which is not at all aligned with the gold standard, which as clinicians we're used to using when making evidence and evidence-based decisions. Industry are also very interested in what can be done to be looking at earlier HTA approvals, earlier agreements for medicines that can be used within the Scottish healthcare system, but conditionally. So is there an opportunity to be doing exactly what Lee's talking about, collecting the evidence as the medicines are being used actively in patients with people who are experiencing both the condition and the medicines and the consequences, both good and bad, of the medicines, and being able to play that back into what the true value of the medicine is. And it plays into other aspects of, when we talk about patient access schemes, more or less we talk at the moment about simple discounts, but there are many other ways to actually be truly looking at the value of the medicine rather than modification of the price of the medicine. There are some medicines that are going to be coming through in the next few years where if you made the medicine free, it would still have a cost per quali that would be above 50, 60,000. Purely as a consequence of the way that the medicine might be introduced. So the cost of the medicine per se is not the only aspect we should be looking at, and industry are very interested, as patient groups are, in terms of working out how we could be making that part of our reality.
Any other views on that? When you put it like that, I mean, it does play into some of the other evaluation of the justification of spend at the health board, and indeed, what's the best treatment for patients as well? Because sometimes access to these drugs and new drugs is not always the best treatment. If we look in the, some recent comments from the chief medical officer in terms of woman medication and what's best for the patient here. So is there any, what is going on out there to evaluate the benefits and justify the costs, and is there any body or groups that come together to do any of this work that Lee suggested? Yes.
I can only speak with limited knowledge here, but there certainly has been quite a large exercise to with cancer drugs. All cancer drugs are prescribed used by a computerised system which uses the same database throughout Scotland. The idea is that will give us the opportunity to actually draw together all information for every patient who's prescribed these drugs within the NHS, within Scotland. And so there is work ongoing. I don't know, Aileen may have a bit more information. I don't know. There is work ongoing to try and harmonise those systems so that we can deliver more data. I think, though, it is really important to manage at this point the expectations, because it's actually very difficult to quantify the benefit a drug gives to an individual patient. So I'm not saying we shouldn't do it. It's important. But I wouldn't want to raise expectations that we can say this drug delivered so many quality of life years gained.
There's a downside to that as well.
Yeah.
How difficult would it do to get an exercise off the ground? Is it, what level of work is taking place?
I would agree with Rob. There is certainly work ongoing to try and bring together reporting mechanisms out of a prescribing system. And this is sometimes the challenge, that we've got an IT system that's brought into use for one reason, and then we try to use it for another reason at the end, and that inevitably makes it more difficult. So we're trying to use a prescribing system that might be used slightly differently in different boards to get out similar data. We do within GGC try to do basically some small scale work around individual medicines and how the patients respond in a real life situation. At the moment, that's a very long hand, laborious methodology, because it has to be done by people in a long hand way. Perhaps once work moves forward in terms of reporting out of the prescribing systems, we would be in a better position to do that. So we may be able to do some small scale work around that, but to have something that would be a large scale post-marketing exercise seems to me a bit out of reach at the moment. I guess Sandra would be able to tell us how much a robust clinical trial costs. Well, post-marketing pieces of work to get robust data would also have a cost attached to it that would be, I imagine, quite large.
Sandra?
Certainly, what was coming to mind as you were speaking is that this is something that industry would be really willing to collaborate on. And, you know, we see that this should be a collaborative venture, and we would be willing to work with the NHS in putting systems in place.
Okay. Lee?
Sorry, Duncan. There is a system which has been presented and accepted by the IT systems people, whoever they may be, within Scottish Government. And this is so defined that a patient with an iPhone can input their own data on a side effect or whatever as it happens. It has been used in some disease areas. Some health boards are interested in it. And hopefully it will evolve and will happen for all of us. But we've also got the problem that medicine is evolving at such a stage too, and we have stratified medicine coming along. So the system is going to have to be constantly evolving, because you may have a situation where you've got three patients in the whole of Scotland in need of a particular stratified drug.
But from the health board's point of view, they want to use this evaluation and all sorts of procedures, and this might be a good argument for that, looking at the outcome. So it's not just in terms of cancer drugs, I don't think. We're talking about drugs for rare diseases. Richard Lyle.
Thank you, Convener. Can I say that the point that Leslie Lollinger said earlier on, I totally agree with. At the end of the day, you know, if you can try and keep people in their home and, you know, look at the cost, you know, the cost you maybe save, you could lengthen the person's life, hopefully, and save, you know. So the cost, is, as far as I'm concerned as a politician, shouldn't come into it. I know it does for Mark White. But can I turn to some of the evidence which we've been given? Cross-border differences are fewer now than earlier in 2013. Indeed, there are some drugs which are accepted for use in NHS Scotland which are not accessible in NHS England. Why is that? And, you know, the concern I have that there are drugs that are accepted in England and still SMC are not accepting them in Scotland, why can't we have NICE and SMC working together? If they evaluate a drug, and maybe Professor Rob Jones would want to answer this, one of the agencies accept a drug, why shouldn't the other agency accept their findings and both have a running, and throughout the United Kingdom, if I want to use that word, that we can ensure that we're evaluating. And again, can someone correct me? I thought that NICE decides the price and we have to follow. I'd love the point that we could get a strong-armed person in to cut a few pence off some of the prices, but most of the drug companies say to me, well, it costs us millions to develop these prices, develop these drugs, so we need to recoup our money back. But maybe Professor Jones could inform me why we don't have an acceptance on both sides of the border.
So I raised this point about cross-border differences simply because actually that's what causes patients a lot of anxiety if they perceive that they can't access a drug which they know they could access if they had an English postcode. We have different. The NHS is very different between Scotland and England, and I think we have to have our own processes. I guess it's not for me to decide how things differ across the English border, but
it seems to me very difficult to see how we could entirely have an independent healthcare system where we would have to follow decisions entirely made by another country.
I would hope that they would follow our decision.
The Scottish decision comes before the NICE decision. Remember that England have had this cancer drugs fund, which has enabled more rapid access prior to a NICE decision. But I don't think we debated this at the time, and there was no appetite in Scotland that I could detect for anybody to want an English cancer drugs fund in Scotland. And it's if you see where it's going, I think we were right.
As to the first question, some of the differentiation actually does sit with the definitions that we use in Scotland particularly. So, for example, around end of life, where our end of life definition is 3 years or less, whereas in England the end of life definition is 2 years or less. The other thing is in Scotland is that we don't set a threshold per se. So, yes, as a committee member, we have thoughts on the cost per quality and the implications of that, but there is no set numbers which define our decisions, whereas in NICE, there is much more definition that sits behind the process. So those, I would suggest, are the major differentiators as to why we get stuff through in Scotland, whereas in England, you might actually not necessarily see medicines getting through. With regards to the second question, if I may, is that NICE don't set price either. NICE are purely, they're an HTA body, so very similar to Scotland, they use a different process, but their job is to actually determine the value in terms of the cost effectiveness of that medicine. The price is actually defined, or it's set in collaboration with the, I suppose, the UK government. It's actually a defined responsibility of the UK government. What companies then do is they offer discounts on those prices. So the price is set because it's got international implications at a level, and then it's discounted from that point onwards. But NICE do the same as SMC do, cost effectiveness.
Okay. The other question I want to ask is, strong concerns have been expressed regarding the number of submission deferrals being experienced by companies. What appears to be a limited factor regarding throughput of 3 PACE submissions per month? The SMC process do evolve. We question, does it have the right resources and the right skills in the right place? Do SMC have the correct support that they require in order to basically adhere to the decisions that we're making?
One of the pleasures of the role that I do is I actually get to see it from both the industry perspective and the SMC perspective. From the industry perspective, my answer is that over the last 12, 18 months, what we've seen is a significant number of new medicines coming through as a consequence of company pipelines starting to deliver. So we've seen companies become much more efficient and much more effective in developing their medicines. The consequence of that is that new medicines get licensed, more medicines get licensed, and they come through to health technology bodies such as SMC. SMC's got an embrace all medicines strategy, which means that virtually all new medicines have to be considered by SMC in one way or another. My own feeling on this is that we are now at a stage where we are seeing the pipeline of medicines and the number of medicines and critically the complexity of those medicines just continuing to grow with an SMC structure which is fully cognizant of the transitions that are happening. The conversations I have with SMC, they know this is happening, but the resources are actually behind the pipeline delivery. I think SMC will need more resources, and we're going to see more complex medicines, probably more PACE medicines, more complex decisions having to be made by the infrastructure of SMC and the committees.
Any other responses there? No other comments on that? Yes.
There's also resource implications for as far as PACE is concerned, with health board representatives and patient groups and charities. It's not just specifically SMC resources, it's the resources that PACE puts onto those other organisations as well, in enabling them to attend and contribute to the meetings.
Does that impact, Mark, in terms of the wider costs, the processes and the involvement on the health board?
It contributes to the bottom line that we've got to then try and manage internally. It's as simple as that, really.
So there is a cost, but it's not been defined.
Yeah, effectively. And then you have to work back and try and establish what it will be and build it into your budget, manage it in the best way you can.
Natalie?
There can be a real impact upon patient organisations, particularly those for very small disease areas, where maybe it is just one person who heads up an organisation UK-wide, perhaps somebody who just provides peer support to other patients and doesn't perhaps get involved in these kind of processes. So there is a real capacity issue for a lot of patient groups to be involved. I think the patient and public involvement team at SMC have been absolutely excellent in providing as much support and advice as they can to help these smaller groups through the process, but there will be times when patient groups just won't be there. And I think it's recognising how you adapt in those situations as well.
Dr. Jones wants to say anything about the clinical input to PACE and the demands that puts on the system as far as clinic time and patient-facing time.
Certainly, clinicians have a number of calls on their time. I would like to think that clinicians would prioritise this kind of activity, however, because we do perceive we put our very high value on it, and that was very clear when I discussed this with my colleagues. We're maybe a bit luckier in Glasgow because the meetings are held in Glasgow. I know there's difficulties getting people in from the other areas.
Sorry, I was just going to follow up on that and suggest that I think that is true. The physical aspect of attending a meeting can be difficult, but I know that a lot of clinicians from other health board areas do try and teleconference in or video conference in, so they certainly do try and make, I think, efforts to take part in a process. As you say, it's extra dialogue that they seem to value.
Leslie?
I was just going to say yes, as somebody who runs a charity on her own, obviously it's financial impact to go to these meetings, but I have to say that attending the PACE meeting was incredibly important and very valuable. And from my clinician's perspective, it was time out, obviously, of a very busy work schedule, but she also said how amazingly valuable it was to attend. I will just always come back to the fact that the wish that I had for this whole process when we started was that we would have a clearer understanding of exactly what you were saying about the overall cost, not just the bottom line cost of the drug. And as Richard very kindly brought up again, if we had some kind of mechanism, even like a price per each individual thing that can happen to a patient that's over and above the drug in question, something that you could say, look, this is what it would cost for a person with this ultra orphan condition if they did not have the drug, then I think that's something that would make the PACE system a lot better.
I'm sorry to repeat it, but the PACE system is brilliant and we are well supported to do it, but I am very concerned about the clinician time. We have one part-time clinician in the west of Scotland looking after melanoma patients. Now, one of the advantages of the new drugs has been that the clinics have grown. Because people are surviving longer, and the numbers of people going along to clinics on a regular basis has actually multiplied. So this one part-time clinician's workload has grown enormously, and she's having to take time out to go to PACE meetings. And it just so happens that we've had four of them in the past, you know, since the PACE meeting started. I really feel that the clinician's place needs to be at the final meeting. I feel it would be a better use of the time, because there is an impact on patients. If people have to wait longer because their clinic timing, you know, they might be due today and their clinic visit put back for 2 weeks because there's no one to see them, then there's this constant add-on of the system and the bureaucracy. We have to use a clinician where they can be of most value, and that's either at new drugs where the first decisions are made or at the final stage, rather than bringing them in at pace. And we've got to make sure that in future there's a clear division between the what's happening in that phase between the New Drugs Committee deciding that a drug is too expensive and it going to pace, because that's the time when the pass comes into play. And if the final decision is really made on the drug discount, then it's such a waste of time of not just the small charities, but also of the clinician going along to a PACE meeting, taking up everyone's time, when really the difference has been made by the fact that the cost has been dropped. And I'm sure everybody would, with any experience of this, would agree with me. We need to have that separated out.
Okay. Any other members? I suppose the ongoing thing is we're looking at some of the evidence in terms of how the new medicine fund is funded now, based on the share of the rebate. Andrew Walker points out that there's a new agreement due in 2018. Is the rebate going to be as generous? If it's not, how do you sustain this? Are the boards themselves able to sustain this? Or the question within that question in my briefing here is there more cost-effective treatments that are being used elsewhere that should play into some of this? Anyone want to take any of that? I think you started to answer it, Mark, in terms of you're in a good position now because the Scottish Government is through this system. That money flows to the boards to deal with that. Is it the best way to use it? Are there other cost-effective treatments that could be given a similar results?
It would be an area that would be worth looking at more. The New Medicines Fund, as I mentioned before, has been a very welcome source of funding, and it has enabled boards at the front line to be able to devote resources to exactly the kind of drugs we've talked about today. In terms of the renegotiation going forward, not cited in that at the moment. I don't know how that will pan out. I guess that's these things are determined very much at a UK level as much as a Scottish Government level. So I would hope it would result in similar funding sources as we've seen in the last 2 to 3 years, but again, not sure how that will pan out. In terms of other cost-effective methods, our pharmacists are continually looking at that and reviewing that. That is a challenging area that we need their expertise brought to the table.
I'm just seeing does anyone else have any insights into the? Well, it's a bit early, but if you're running this scheme and £90 million budget, £23 million goes into Glasgow, there's a renegotiation in 2018. We should be starting to have an appreciation about what's going to happen. And it may be more appropriate to ask the Cabinet Secretary or whatever, but there's no insights about that.
From a pharmaceutical industry point of view, no, I'm not able to shed any light on that. What I would do is to continue to applaud Scottish Government's stance on allocation of the payback from the current PPRS, which has left Scotland the being lauded by other being envied by other nations. What I would also suggest, though, moving forward, would it be reasonable for other interventions to be afforded the same sort of scrutiny as medicines are, other interventions, so that medicines just aren't looked at in the singular way that they are. Maybe that would be something to look at moving forward.
Yeah, it's a fair challenge. I mean, if you look at the whole healthcare system and the patient's journey, there's not many other areas are scrutinised as much as medicines. And we have debated today, you know, the wider sort of costs around about the added value and the knock-on effects and the wider implications. And it's true that there is many other areas of system that level of rigour is not applied, a point which is not applied. And it's maybe a debate for another time as to whether that should be a further development of this kind of process.
Yes, Catriona.
Again, it's not unique to the Scottish healthcare system and by any means, but it's very much adding new to the system and not decommissioning the old. So, you know, there might be some opportunity, and I think it's very much aligned with what Mark's actually saying. And it's about being able to identify the old that can be stripped out to be able to find funding potentially.
The other one I've got here is the threshold and the quality of the £30,000. Is that too high? Could it be harming people, given that drugs are made available above the 30,000 threshold? Catriona?
In terms of my understanding of the system and working in it as well, there is no actual threshold. So the new drugs committee, they work to a very tight process, and therefore they apply a threshold. My understanding is 20,000. And if you're under that, then you'll get an approval through the NDC as long as other parameters are defined. If you're over that, then you get an automatic rejection by the NDC, and that's because they do work within a very tight process of ensuring that the analysis and the assessments are done to very high quality and very high rigour. It's thereafter at the SMC that modifiers can be applied, and people can actually draw their own conclusions as a consequence of the value of a medicine. And at the SMC, there is no defined threshold per se as to what is approvable and what isn't approvable. And I think that's what you're seeing. There's reflection of that within the different range of the cost per qualities and the ICERs that come through the system. So I think we could talk about whether 30 is enough or not enough or too high. But in actual fact, it's a number that isn't actually applied to any massive degree in the system. So
that's a trigger. I can trigger a bureaucratic process if it was set at a different level. It might reduce some of the burden on there.
So one of the conversations we're having in industry is whether there is a possibility for decisions to be maybe fast-tracked as a consequence of the threshold that's being achieved. But that's, you know, we're very, very early in conversations on those opportunities. But I'm sorry to say this, but it deals with the medicines that aren't actually much of a problem to us. The conversations that we're having around this table today are probably not the medicines that would actually fall into those easier decision frameworks. So it's being able to meet the needs of today, the needs of the future, by giving capacity rather than actually assisting the decisions of the medicines around this table.
Okay. Natalie?
Absolutely. I mean, I think whilst there is no defined threshold within the SMC, it doesn't mean one doesn't necessarily exist. I think there was some statistics in one of the submissions that I read that suggested that a medicine that's at the 60,000 to 70,000 threshold isn't likely to get through the system. So whilst there is not a defined threshold, it doesn't mean that it can be prohibitive. And I think that's where we have to step back to looking at how can we future-proof this going forward, because no doubt more medicines that are more complex will come through and they will command a higher price. So it's making sure that the process is robust enough to assess those medicines, and whether that is to do it with quality plus something else or no qualities at all, I think that's what really has to be the next step and what we look at.
Okay. Lynette.
Back a little bit. When you're talking about looking at other systems than drugs and perhaps decommissioning things that are not cost effective, I think that was something the Health Committee did agonise over a bit when we were doing our original inquiry, and I just wonder if that's something that maybe a future Health Committee could be encouraged to actually look at and take some evidence on. But what I was actually wondering about the current uptake of the new medicines fund. We spoke about what might happen in the future. We know what Glasgow and Clyde are getting from the fund. Do we know if other health boards are actually using up their allocations from this fund? Is there any money going spare, you might say? And if so, should there be a fairer way of perhaps sorting it out?
I don't think there's anyone here that can give us those figures, but we can request them.
Quite useful to know, I think.
We can. Richard?
One question that hasn't been asked, and I want to touch on it, and kind of, first of all, thank everyone who, I know you're very committed in order to help people and patients. And I think at the end of the day, and Leslie was talking about it earlier, you know, our first priority is to help patients. So we're reminded there's a need for an increase of the number and type of patient voice on all decision-making panels of SMC. Does every witness support that view? And again, I know it's impossible to target each person onto a particular panel who may be interested in a particular disease, but you know, should we have more patients who are driving for patients? What should be the best for patients?
Lastly.
Answer is absolutely. I think having a patient perspective on any panel or any decision-making body is really important, regardless of whether they have a personal interest or not. The perspective a patient can give is really unique, and they can lend that to discussions from other patients as well and provide an aspect to that discussion that is maybe missing at the moment.
Sandra, and then, sorry, Leslie, you're on my blind side, you see.
Your
then,
line of
then
view.
Leslie.
Your line of vision. The user group for the SMC user group forum has been working and has produced some work just now where companies are have made available information to go to patient organisations to help them with what they can contribute to their patient group submission. So industry is working quite hard along with SMC to try and help the quality of information improve so that submissions, the ultimate submissions are better.
I was just going to say that although each rare condition has its own set of issues, there is a lot of commonality between them. So having a patient, as many patient representatives wherever possible, I would say is excellent. Thank you.
Adelaide.
The Patient Involvement Network, which is a subgroup that the SMC's public involvement team have set up, has been a really positive step as well. So that has brought together representatives mostly of umbrella organisations, but also patient groups that have been through the process. And it's been a really good opportunity to feedback what is working and where some issues could be improved, certainly around things like guidance for patient groups going through the process. So that's been a really positive step going forward, and I would hope that that would continue to grow as, I suppose, the SMC does.
Thanks for that. To complete the questions, in 2009, the Scottish Government issued guidance, and I think this is basically to our board representatives here, which clarified that patients could privately fund part of their treatment while still being treated by the NHS, and if they wanted to pay to access a drug that wasn't available or had not been recommended by the SMC. Do you keep track of that? Do you know that? Yes, Aileen?
That advice is still extant, and so patients can still utilise that route. It's a very rare occurrence, I have to say, but it does occasionally happen.
I suppose what we're looking at, is it rarer now? Do you keep track of it? How many patients, within Glasgow Clyde take advantage of that mechanism at this point?
Yeah, and I can't tell you the figure for that over a certain period, but it's only been used very occasionally, occasionally.
But we don't really keep track of it.
We would keep track of it. I just couldn't tell you what the figure for the past year was.
But public record, then you can share.
We would be able to have information on that.
That's fine. Lee?
We've had one patient who paid £90,000 for her treatment because it wasn't available, IPTR or any other way. And the process took about 3 months. The first price that was given was £75,000. Then we discovered it was plus VAT. And it was a long, arduous process for the patient and her family. And they had to give up a great deal to achieve this. And at the end of the day, it didn't make a blind bit of difference. By the time she got the drug, she had a brain secondary and died within weeks of starting the treatment. So, yes, by all means, people should be allowed to make up their own mind about how they want to spend money they've earned, and no doubt pay tax on, but the process has to be very much faster, or else with cancer, it's growing all the time and they're just going to be throwing their money away. And I think it would be beholden on drug companies to at least offer patients who go down this route the best price that they've made available to the SMC rather than the full cost plus the VAT.
But we're just trying to establish, complete the questions here today about whether it's been affected or not, whether there's still a current use of it, whether it's declined or whatever. So, I mean, we'll take it, the whatever information is available, and it wasn't a key question this morning. We've come to that point that there's no other questions, but on the way home, we don't want you to be saying, oh, I should have said this. So now's your chance. I'm happy to go around the table. If there's one thing that you want to leave with the committee and our considerations for our more legacy work at this stage, but Leslie?
I think that the changes that have been made have been remarkable. I think the SMC has really picked up the most amazing amount of work. It's been remarkable. I just would ask for increased transparency at every level. My clinician doesn't always know what's happening, and she can't give a response to patients, and that can be very hard. So just transparency for me is the big thing.
Okay. You're not compelled to do this, but if you've got something in your head, Lee?
I want to reiterate the GGHB point that there's no encouragement for the industry to quote its best price up front, which delays access and requires more NHS time revisiting cost efficiency mid-process. And lastly, like Leslie, I would like to thank the SMC staff who've been involved in this evolving process. The PACE process has been of great assistance, and we especially value the kindness which they have shown when patients are attending, and for the clinicians who have given evidence and therefore have to catch up with their clinical work at some other stage, probably meaning going home late to their families night after night. And obviously to the Health and Sports Committee for all the work that you've put in. It must have been very onerous, and we really do appreciate it. Thank you very much.
I think we'll just stop at that. Natalie.
Nice things too. I definitely commend the work of the committee on this. It has been an ongoing and long piece of work, and I think we're really drilling down to the real bedrock of the issues now, and I think that's really testament to the commitment that this committee has had. I would also really commend the SMC for taking forward the changes in such a positive manner and through such engagement with patient organisations as well. I think for me there's two key points to look at going forward that really will drill down how we move forward. The first is evaluating exactly how decisions are being made at SMC and what really is the impact of PACE. And I think transparency around the IPTR and PACS transition is incredibly important as well.
Anyone else? Sandra.
Not surprisingly, really. So again, just to echo the thanks to the committee for undertaking this evidence session and previously. One area that I wanted to highlight that industry had as a continued concern, and also one that was raised by a couple of other submissions to the committee, was around the voting process within the SMC committee. There is some feeling that the voting it doesn't allow the same transparency as is aimed for, and there have been occasions where the decision reached hasn't necessarily been mirrored by the discussion that's gone beforehand. The knock-on effect to that has been on a couple of occasions where companies can go back to SMC having had a not recommended or not accepted, looking for some guidance as to how they might tailor a new submission. And the information that SMC has been able to give the company has been a personal view rather than based on the view of the committee, because it's not known how individuals voted. So that hasn't been helpful as far as a company moving forward. And I don't know if Katrina, you wanted to add anything on that issue?
So with regards to the voting, it's to be able to ensure that the first resubmission doesn't transition to the second and doesn't transition to the third, it is really important that companies get the message very clearly as to the basis of in a non-recommended position. And at the moment, that just doesn't exist. It just fits into the overarching call of greater transparency across different aspects. The other piece that I would like to add is another aspect of your examination was around the Scottish model of value. And the fact that at this point in time, whilst we've got improvements in SMC process, in terms of actually defining what a Scottish model of value is, I personally am not necessarily seeing it as tightly defined or as shaped as perhaps would be of great assistance both to patients, patient groups and industry and SMC in terms of defining what we need to be doing. We talk about the quality threshold, we talk about price, we talk about other things, but the essence is value, and I don't think we've actually defined what we value and therefore what should be fitting into the value equations. So they've not been done yet.
I see a lot of nodding at that. At that point, it might be, an omission on our part. But I mean, so if people want to say something on that issue of value, we okay? Right, okay. Well, thank you all for being with us again. Thanks for your kind comments and the committee's work. It wasn't the committee that did it. It was the people who participated in that in those committee hearings, gave evidence, written submissions, and it's heartening to learn that some progress is made, and we've got with the evidence this morning, a good model in place. Of course, it can be improved, and hopefully we can work together and with future committees to ensure that. Future-proofing and we maintain what's good in the system that we possibly have and improve it. Thank you all very much for being here this morning and giving your precious time. Thank you. I'm going to suspend at this point and go into private session as we previously agreed. Thank you all very much.